Only a short review from previous lecture. So last time we discussed about introduction to statistical testing. So the first what should be repeated is that if we apply statistical tests, we usually try to generalize our information from the sample to the whole population. That's necessary to remember. That's the basic. And the test is usually consisting of two competing hypotheses. Usually the first one is called null hypothesis and we use symbol H null. The alternative hypothesis is usually described as H1, and null hypothesis usually says, okay, there is no difference or there is no relationship. So this is hypothesis about zero difference and relationship, which is absent, so it is also zero, we can say. So that's classical null hypothesis nearly for all statistical tests and for all statistical tests that are covered in this course. Alternative hypothesis says, it's quite easy to guess, that there is some difference. Or there is some relationship. Some very easy examples. For imagine we would like to study the difference in average income between, for example, Czech and Moravia. So two parts of the Czech Republic. So our null hypothesis could be, okay, there is no difference at all. So average income in the Czech part as well as in Moravian part and Bohemian part is all the same. Alternative, there is some difference. So that's hypothesis about differences. Hypothesis about relationship between two or more variables. So for example, we can try to measure relationship between education of the respondent and his or her father. And we can start, but it wouldn't be so wise, with the hypothesis there is no relationship. So your education is not influenced at all by education of your father. Alternative hypothesis would be there is some relationship between these two variables. So these are classical hypotheses. And the last short repetition is related to the evaluation of statistical tests. So at the end, after some computations, we will compute usually probability of first type error, and I would like to repeat that usually we use symbol alpha for this computed probability of first type error. What does it mean, this probability? It's probability that you reject null hypothesis about null difference, no relationship, but in reality it means in the population this hypothesis is valid. So probability that you incorrectly reject valid null hypothesis, that's alpha, computed probability of first type error. And now I'd like to ask you some question. I hope you remember at least something from previous lecture. What size of this alpha we usually are able to accept in social sciences? What is recommended level for this alpha that shouldn't be exceeded?
Less than 0.05.
Yeah, usually 5%, or if you like decimals, 0.05. That's classical level. And if we compute, or of course not we directly, but we by the computer compute this probability, so if it will be lower than 0.05, we will say, okay, we do not such a big mistake if we reject null hypothesis, so I use this symbol, and we will accept alternative one. It means we will say, okay, there is difference between Bohemian and Moravian part, for example, in the average income, there is relationship between respondent's education and education of his or her father, etc., etc. And if opposite is true, so it means your computed alpha, it means probability of first type error, will exceed 0.05 or will be equal to 0.05, you will do weaker statement. You will say, I do not reject null hypothesis. So you will not say, I accept or I proven null hypothesis, but you only say, we do not have enough proofs to reject it. Once again, this is the same as we discussed previously, the example about trial before the court after the crime is committed, that judge will say, okay, he is guilty, but judge will not say he is innocent. He will say, I do not have enough evidence to prove his or her guilty. So that's the same logic. So please take it as it is. If you do not remember statistical reasoning, let's go to reasoning of the judge. And it's quite easy to remember, I guess. So if you write into your homework or into the test that you have proven null hypothesis, it's nonsense from statistical point of view. We do not try to prove null hypothesis. We only try to reject null hypothesis and prove alternative one. Okay, so that's it. And last comment, which will be very important for us, is that this alpha is usually named in many, many different ways in statistical softwares. But SPSS usually use for this computed probability of first type error shortage, which is called SIG, which stands for significance, or the full expression would be statistical significance. So this probability of first type error, it means probability of incorrect rejection of null hypothesis, is called usually statistical significance, and SPSS use shortage, which is called SIG. So if you will see SIG, it will be result of some statistical testing in SPSS. We will see in few minutes some example. Okay, so that's it. Okay, and now we will start with, I hope so, the easiest tests that can be carried out in statistics. And these tests are usually called t-tests. The t stands for t-distribution, which is quite well-known statistical distribution, which is very, very similar to normal distribution. Let's go back. I hope you remember that normal distribution curve is like flowing bell-shaped curve. And the only difference, and maybe we will tell in a few minutes that we are providing t-tests, but maybe we are providing normal tests. So t-distribution is very, very similar to normal distribution, only it has something the statistician calls heavy tails. So it will start longer at the left part and will be something like this one. So it means that instead of value, for example, 2, we discussed many times here, we will use something like 2.52 or something like this. So only these critical values of quantiles of normal distribution are replaced by t-distribution. And this t-distribution has also one more property, as normal distribution is not influenced by the sample size. It means it doesn't matter how big your data are. T-distribution is influenced by sample size. So for example, if you will have 20 values, it will be like this one. If you will have only 10 values, so it will be like this one. So more heavy tails, etc., etc. So the lower the number of respondents is, the more heavy tails t-distribution follows. But one very easy recommendation to this theoretical discussion is that if you have at least approximately 30 units in your data file, it means you have 30 respondents, 30 families, etc., etc., you do not have to use t-distribution, and you can use only classical normal distribution, as it converges t-distribution to normal distribution approximately about the size of 30 respondents. So we will not, in practice, compute t-test, but we will compute normal test, we could say. But usually we call these tests t-test, so we will follow this classical logic. So first of all, what is the purpose of t-tests? So I would say that instead of t-tests, or sometimes z-tests, we call it if we discuss about normal distribution, so we can say that these tests are about means. So if you like to know what is it about, what we would like to test in these tests, we would like to test means. And there is only very short notice here, but it's very important that you can use it as well also for proportions for some binary variables. So it doesn't matter whether your variable is cardinal and you can compute mean from this variable, or if your variable is binary variable, usually coded as 0, 1, and you can use it also for proportions testing. So for means as well as proportions. The same logic as previously we discussed about confidence interval. The same procedure can be applied to means as well as to proportions. Okay, and let's start to discuss three possible applications of t-tests, as there are only three t-tests existing. So the first one, and I would like, it's not very useful at all, but we will show some example, is so-called one-sample t-test. So example for this test from the real data analysis practice. So let's imagine you would like to find whether, for example, average income is changing from previous year. Maybe you know from previous research, or maybe from some census, that income on average last year was approximately 10,000. And now you would carry out your own research, you would take your survey, and you would compute average income in your data, and it would be, for example, 10,500. And now the question is, okay, these are my data, this is only sample. And is it possible that in the whole population, still the average is 10,000 Czech crowns or another currency in which we are measuring, or not? And that's t-test for one sample only. We have only one data file, and we are comparing with some previously defined, let's call it benchmark. So you have some hypothesis about the value of the average, and you have your own data sample, and you would like to know whether average in the whole population can be like your hypothesis say. So that's one sample t-test. There are some assumptions. You can find it on the next slide, and these assumptions are following. So if you are carry out any of these t-tests, you should use it, as it is about means, only for cardinal variables. So now the question is whether income is cardinal variable, and the answer is yes, it seems it is. So we will meet this assumption. The next assumption is slightly more problematic, but not very often we will discuss, that your cardinal variable should be normal distributed. It means if you, for example, would draw a chart, classical chart histogram, so it should be bell-shaped curve. But if you have big samples, and now maybe it will be surprising for you, but the reason behind is, as we discussed previously, big sample means in statistics usually more than 30 units, then normal distribution is not necessary. We usually call t-tests as they are robust. So they can compute quite correctly in spite of the fact that this assumption of normality is not met in our data. So if you have big data, you do not have to draw a picture and try to find whether your distribution is normally distributed or not. But if your data are small one, it means less than 30 units in your data file, then you should check normal distribution. And if it is normal, if your variable is not normally distributed, you have to use another techniques. We will discuss about it later, and we will call these techniques as non-parametric tests. So that's only the basic of this discussion. And here you have also notice that if we are discussing about t-tests, so they are usually called in general as parametric tests, as we have some assumptions, some requirements. If they do not follow these requirements or assumptions, we have to use alternative, which is called non-parametric tests. Okay, so this is basic discussion. We know something about testing, and we only do not know how to compute t-tests or another test in SPSS environment. So let's start. So I would propose that we will use the variable we are quite familiar with, and that is the fifth variable in our data file about income. As we discussed about income, so it's quite easy to guess that it would be the best one for our discussion. So income B41A, and first of all, let's repeat that there are some strange values included in this variable: zeros, 6 8s, and 6 9s. These are artificial values, people without an income and people refusing or not answering about their level of income. So first of all, we have to go into variable view and define missing values. So three discrete missing values. Okay, so that's the introduction into the analysis, checking of data, and definition of missing values. Okay, next step. If we would like to apply the test, we should know something about hypotheses for this test, and we should compute it. So, null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis for one sample t-test. So, let's propose some null hypothesis. What is my expectation that average income, it is average net income per month here in the Czech crowns, was present in the Czech population approximately 15 years ago. So Czech students can help us. Some proposal that average level, I would only add that in statistics we use for the average in the population symbol from Greek, which is me. And now only let's set some value which will be our null hypothesis. So what is our expectation that average income per month, it is net income, was in the Czech population 15 years ago?
Is it the same like today?
Yeah. No, I would like to give some proposal. If you say it's 5,000, 10,000, 20,000. So let's try to propose some value.
11.
Okay, thanks a lot. So 11,000. So that's our null hypothesis. So we will try to test that the average income in the Czech population 15 years ago, as we have quite old data, was 11,000 Czech crowns. And alternative hypothesis, it's easy to guess, is it is another value, not 11,000. Okay. So let's try to compute it. So, let's go into analyze. And all t-tests can be found in the fourth procedure, which is called generally compare means. It's not a big surprise if we are discussing about means that we are following procedure, which is called compare means. And the first procedure is mainly for descriptive statistics called means. And then you have one sample t-test, independent samples t-test, and per samples t-test. We will use first two from this option. So the first one we will use is one sample t-test. As we have only one data about all Czech people, of course it is only sample, so we have one sample, and we would like to generalize to the population and answer the question whether it is possible that average income was 15 years ago 11,000 or not. So one sample t-test. Okay, so first of all, we have to move our variable in which we are interested, it means the fifth one, income, B41A, to the right window. So it is tested variable, as you can read it here. And the next necessary part of this dialogue is that you have to say, what is your null hypothesis? What would you like to test? And here is the window, which is called test value. And you can see by default, SPSS expects you will test null hypothesis that the average in the whole population is zero. But it's nonsense if we are discussing about income. So we would type 11,000. Okay, 11,000 Czech crowns. And that's enough for this time, but maybe stop and click also into options. And you can see that by default, there will be some confidence interval and it will be 95% confidence interval by default. You can change it if you like 90, 99, you can change the level of the precision of the confidence interval. So that's it. So click on OK and let's see our results. In spite of the fact we are asking for t-test, SPSS will offer you also some descriptive statistics for your data, just in case you haven't checked your data previously. So SPSS will tell you, okay, my computation is based on 854 respondents. These are all people who answered the question about their level of income. The average or mean in our sample is approximately 9,700. So quite far below expected level. So at least we can have some idea before the testing itself. It doesn't seem if I use quite big number of respondents and my computation says it is below 10,000, that the average in the population will be 11,000. So at least at the beginning I expect that I will have to reject null hypothesis. That's my expectation still. That's subjective. Then we will use some objective procedure testing and we will discuss whether we are correct or not in our expectation. Okay. So that's general description. You can also read about standard deviation, and that's all. You can also have here standard error of mean, and we know from previous discussion that if you would like to compute confidence interval, that's very easy. You take mean plus minus 2 times standard error. So your confidence interval would be approximately 9,000 and 7 minus 4, so it's 300, and the upper bound of this confidence interval will be approximately 10,000 and 100. So this range doesn't cover the tested value. So my expectation that I will have to reject null hypothesis is even stronger than previously. Okay, but do not expect anything, and let's try to see the test itself. So, here's the test. As it is, t-test, so the statistics which is computed by a computer by some formula, and it's quite easy formula, so I will write it for you. So if you would like to compute t-test, so you would take following equation. T is equal to x average, it means average in our data, minus expected level, it means me, according to null hypothesis, divided by standard error. So if you would take this figure, 9668 minus 11,000 and divided by standard error mean, you would get approximately 6.5, if I round it up to the first decimal place. Okay, then there is something what is called degrees of freedom. DF is shortage for this concept, and it's very easy to say that for one sample t-test, DF is computed as number of respondents minus one. You have here the information, we have 854 respondents, minus one, it's 853. So it's only for computation, and then, and usually people do not see another part of this table is the column which is called significance. As we discussed previously, it is probability of first type error. And let's see it, 0.000. I would say this is not zero. Only if I round up to the third decimal place, there is no valid value. So it is lower than 0.0005. Yeah? It's only shortage for this figure. And now the significance is quite low. Very, very low figure. Lower than 5% as we discussed previously. So now we have to decide. This is our case or this is our case. As this one is much lower than this one, so the first case fits to our data. So we would reject null hypothesis and accept alternative one. It means we will say, oh, it's quite improbable that average income in the Czech population was 11,000 15 years ago. It's quite far more probable that this result fits to our data. So we would say, okay, 11,000, no, it's not according to our computation of t-test. And there is also some slightly tricky information in last two columns, which is 95 confidence interval, and it is called of the difference. So if you will read the whole title, maybe you will be able to understand the meaning. So now I would like to ask you if you can interpret this confidence interval of the difference, if you can help me, what is it inside these two columns? What information is hidden here? Any guesses? Or maybe somebody knows, what does it mean? So, very easy interpretation, but not very easy to understand it from this table. So, we have no hypothesis about 11,000 as the average in the whole population. And it doesn't fit. So we rejected this null hypothesis. But this confidence interval says, okay, if you like to know the confidence interval for average in the whole population, so you have to subtract this and this value from this 11,000. So minus 927 and 1737. So, if we slightly round up, and I think that's not the problem, so it will be 10,100, and the lower limit will be 9,300 approximately. So, and this is confidence interval. If you go back to our previous discussion about confidence interval, mean plus minus 2 times standard error, and it's nearly the same. It would be the same if we would compute precisely. We are rounding up to hundreds here. So that's another possibility how to compute confidence interval by t-test procedure. But it's slightly complicated, as you have to know that you need to take your expected value according to no hypothesis and subtract these two values. And now I would like to summarize these results, as we should understand, to tests as well as to confidence interval. And maybe you should select whether to use tests or confidence interval or both of them. So if we apply the test, generally, doesn't matter which one. Now we have one sample t-test, but for all tests, the logic is all the same. You have two competing hypotheses. And mostly, you expect you will reject null hypothesis. That's what usually people are expecting to do. So here, we would only say that the average income isn't in the Czech population 11,000. That's all. So only decision yes or no, I would say. I would say that's only black and white world in testing. You only say this hypothesis is true or I cannot prove it. But the question is, and maybe this is more important, okay, if it is not 11,000, so what can be real value for this average for income in the Czech population? That's the question, not whether it is some value or not. And for this purpose, it's quite more useful to use confidence interval. Doesn't matter if we use direct computation, mean plus minus 2 times standard error, or we use these two columns and subtract it from expected value. The result will be the same, but it informs you about possible level of the statistics in which you are interested. As we are interested, what can be the average income? What can be the proportion of people supporting some activity, etc., etc.? These are all questions. And also, by confidence interval, you can carry out testing, as if confidence interval will include the level which is expected by null hypothesis, then you will do not reject null hypothesis, as maybe this value can be valid for the whole population. But if your confidence interval will not include the level which is expected by null hypothesis, you will reject null hypothesis, as it's quite improbable that the real value is 11,000 according to this confidence interval. So the same decision as we here provided by significance can be also computed or interpreted by results of confidence interval. So confidence interval can be also quite useful for testing and gives you some more information, I would say. So my recommendation, and it is also included in slides, is if you like to compute better results, don't use tests or don't use only tests and compute also confidence interval and interpret it. Okay, Now it's time to ask you whether are there any questions about testing, at least about the first test we are familiar with. Everything is clear, at least as it seems for this time. Okay, so that's the first insight, and we will go farther. And we will move to the second t-test, which is two independent samples t-tests. So we will not compare our data to some expected value for the whole population, but we will compare two groups, independent groups, and we will try to say whether for the whole population, if we would have data for these both groups, the averages in the population for these both groups can be different or not. So now we are generalizing not one sample, but we have two samples, two groups, and we would like to compare these groups. I would say this is the most common t-test in statistics or data analysis. And as we discussed previously, we can use t-tests not only for averages for cardinal variables, but we can use the same test also for proportions. So we will use two independent sample tests for proportions. And our null hypothesis will say, okay, there is no difference for the participation in the last election between and two groups will be men and women. But it can be people from south, people from west, etc., etc. Doesn't matter which criterion you will use for differentiation between two groups. So let's start with data preparation. So what we need for two independent sample t-tests. We need one variable, which is cardinal or binary. And we need a second variable, which will differentiate between two groups. So in our data, it's quite easy to go into. And the first variable in our data set is B48. It's men and women discrimination variable. So the first code is male, and the second one is female. So this is grouping variable, we call it usually in statistics, grouping variable. And our tested variable, will be the variable B1. Which is about last voting participation, so B1. First of all, if you check your data, and let's go into B1 variable, so it's coded as yes, no, and no right to vote, the first one, second one, and the third code for this variable. And as we discussed previously, we can use for t-tests only cardinal or binary data, and these are not strictly binary. We have three codes, so first of all, we should prepare some recoding. So, first of all, I would change the coding of this B1 variable to be only 0, 1. I would propose 0 would be for those who didn't participate and 1, of course, for those who did. So, first of all, let's go into transform and recoding into different variables. So, first of all, we have to choose our tested variable. It means the sixth one, last vote participation. And new one variable can be called for simplicity, for example, vote only. but you can choose another name, it's up to you. Don't forget to click on change. So question tag is not present here and we can flow by definition. So B1 will be recoded into void and old and new values. So I propose that the original value 1 will be also coded as 1 in new variable void, as these are people who participated. And for all other values, so the last one option on the left side of this screen, the new value will be 0. So 1 will be equal to 1 and all other values will be recoded into zeros. Okay, can we follow or are there any problems? No? Okay, so continue and okay. So let's see that in our data there is new column which is called void and only zeros and ones are present here. So it seems, okay, everything is correctly recoded. You can also check that we have 1, 1, 1, 1, blah, 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 2, 0, etc., etc. So it seems correct. And now we will apply t-test. And we are discussing about proportions. We usually do not use me, but we can use it as well as we are technically computing averages. But for proportions, we usually use big P's. So here, for example, I would say that for men and women, if we are comparing proportion, so proportion for men and women is the same. So P me is equal to P W. And what is alternative hypothesis? I think you can help me. The proportion of men participating in the election isn't the same, yeah? Easy to guess. Statistics is very simple discipline, as you know. PW is not equal to PME. Okay, so we have prepared our data. B1 is tested variable. We know that for all people present in our data, gender is defined, so it's only necessary to go into SPSS dialog and compute it. So once again, analyze, compare means, and currently, of course, the third one procedure, which is called independent samples t-test. First of all, I would like to warn you that this output will be slightly more complicated. So first of all, I will go through it very quickly and then we will go into details. So, compare means and independent samples t-test. So our tested variable is the last one we prepared and it is called void in my data file. So move it to the right window called test variable. You can see that there is plural also present here, so you can test more than one variables in one procedure. And the first one variable, gender, will be defined as grouping variable. And now some strange question tags are present here. SPSS is asking about something. And it's asking about definition of individual groups you would like to compare. So, if we would like to compare men and women in our data file, and we know that coding is 1 and 2, so we will type 1 and 2 as group 1, group 2. This is quite useful that you can also use for grouping variable with more than 2 values, and you can decide that only 2 of these possible values will be compared by this procedure. So, it's quite a general procedure, I would say. Continue, and once again, let's go into option. Once again, you see there will be some confidence interval, but once again, slightly strange maybe. And that's all. So click on OK. And now let's go through results. So once again, we didn't ask for any special output, but by default, SPSS will give you some descriptive statistics in the first table called group statistics. So you can see that you have approximately 800, yeah?
Can I just ask, how should I define groups in gender?
1 and 2. As the variable itself is coded 1 and 2, if you click here into gender, 1 male, 2 female. Of course, you have to know from your questionnaire or from your data what is coding. Okay, so here you have number of respondents for individual groups, and here you have means. These means are proportions. Proportions of men and women participating in the last election. So you can see that in our data, now we are discussing about our data, our sample, there is approximately 72% for men who participated in the last election, and for women is slightly lower, approximately 69%. And now the question which we are solving once again is, okay, I can see some small difference in my data, in my sample. If I would ask all people in the whole Czech Republic, would I find any difference or not? Nobody knows. Okay, that's why we use apply t-test. So now, as I promised previously, I will go through this table very, very quickly. So please, do not take into account the first column, and please read the second row. I will explain you why in a few minutes, but now, please believe me, it's quite good strategy. And here you can see, there is once again, so let's do something like this one, as the first row doesn't exist. So the first one column is called T. As it is t-test, so it is computed by some equation, so equation will be following. Now we have two averages from our data, these two. So the first one and the second one average is subtracted. And I will not go into detail, but here would be once again something like standard error. If you like to know more about formulas, try to read some textbooks. And this is the result of T. So you would take this mean minus this mean and divide it by some merge standard error. And you would get 1.7. As you know maybe from previous discussion about normal distribution, that some critical borders are minus 2 and plus 2, where only 5% of all values are outside of this range. So if we are not exceeding the value of 2, we may be expecting some results for the test. There is also some concept for degrees of freedom, but this is quite complicated for most, so we will not go into details. But approximately, it is equal to the number of respondents we have. There are some corrections, but do not discuss about it. And for us, maybe the most important result for t-test here will be significance. Once again, probability of first type error. And now we have the value, which is 0. And let's round up, 0.9. And the question is, this case or this case we can find in our data? Which one? It is below or above or equal to 0.05. This one, yeah? Everybody can see. Okay, so we say we are not allowed to reject null hypothesis as it would be risky. 9% probability of incorrect rejection of null hypothesis will be followed by this data. So we will say, okay, maybe that this hypothesis is true. We don't say it's true, believe it. But we say we cannot reject it. Maybe it's true. So maybe In spite of the fact we can see here some difference, so maybe in the whole population there is no difference at all. That's our conclusion. Okay, and once again, there is some confidence interval of the difference, blah, blah, blah. And here are some very small figures, excuse me, but if it is about proportions, these are by definition a very small one. But this is expected confidence interval for the difference between men and women in the participation for the election. So it will be maybe maximum 8%, but minimum slightly lower than zero. So maybe the difference can be 8%, and maybe it can be also zero. And as this confidence interval, once again, includes zero, that's why we do not reject null hypothesis. As if confidence interval includes zero, the significance will be above 0.05. If this confidence interval will not include zero, this significance will be below 0.05. Once again, the relationship between confidence interval and testing. Of course, it is valid only if you have 95% confidence interval. If you will have another level, so it will be another story. And some more information which can be added to this two independent sample t-test. So once again, if you only use the test itself, you will only say it's the same, maybe it is not the same. So once again, black and white decision, yes or no. If you like to know something more, what can be a real difference in the population, you can use confidence interval. So maybe if there is a difference, there can be, it wouldn't be higher than 8%. So from substantive point of view, it's not very big one. So it's possible to use. And the next possibility, how to interpret these data, is to use something what statisticians usually call effect sizes. What does it mean? And how to measure effect size for this two independent samples t-test? I would start this story with discussion about this statistical significance. So what is this statistical significance about? It will say you whether you can generalize your result from the sample to the population. Nothing more. Only, okay, I can generalize, I cannot. So only this decision can be made through statistical significance. So some statisticians call it that this is only one side of the coin. And what is the second part of the coin if you analyze data? It's substantive significance of your results. Whether you are inquiring something new, something fantastic, by which you will be famous. And this substantive significance can be measured by something what is called usually effect size. So if you like to know whether your result is not statistically significant, it means can be generalized to the population, but better, you have found something special, something for which you will be famous, you compute effect sizes. I would call it in another way as measurement of substantive significance, but usually statisticians call it effect sizes. And effect size for two independent samples t-test is usually called small d, or according to the author as Cohen's D. Psychologist called Cohen invented this effect size as the first one. And how to compute Cohen's D, and of course it's quite bad luck that SPSS will not compute it automatically for you. So Cohen's D can be computed in following way. You will subtract these two averages, So it's the first average and the second one. And then you have to divide it by standard deviation for your data. So in our case, it would be 0.72 blah, 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 minus 0.68 blah, 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 divided by approximately 0.45, I would guess, would be joint standard deviation for the variable. And if you take it only as approximation, so this is approximately 0.03, I guess, divided by 0.45 approximately, so it is approximately 0.1, I guess. That's approximation, but let's take it as this. If we would read Cohen's recommendation, he would say, okay, it doesn't seem substantively significant result. As Cohen say, okay, if it is below 0.2, it's nearly useless result. Then the next level is the range from 0.2, 0.5, and he says, okay, there is some effect. And if it is above 0.8, it's quite big effect at all. So our result, if I would conclude, is not significant from statistical point of view and not significant from substantive point of view. So I would say it's nearly useless. We haven't found anything. But as I usually tell to all my students, also zero and no new finding is the result in the science. At least nobody will follow your way, as it's useless maybe. Okay, so that's effect size. And last discussion which we would follow is why this table is so complicated and why we skip the first row, etc., etc. So very easy, only tool for you. If you like to know more, read Field's textbook. So in the first two columns, there is some special test. It is called Levenes test for equality of variances. So I would say very simply that t-test for two independent groups or samples has two possible options. Option for equal variances and option for not equal variances. These two rows you can find equal variances assumed, equal variances not assumed. And here is some additional tests which will tell you, okay, are there equal variances or are not? And if you can see, this significance for this test of equality of variances has quite low probability of first type error. And you can imagine, null hypothesis will tell, okay, no difference between variances. And alternative will tell, okay, there are some. And if significance is low, here we can use 0.05 without any problem. So if it is low, equal variances cannot be assumed, so you read the second row. If this value will be at least 0.05, you will read for t-test the first one. Yeah? So that's only a technical test which will help you to read the first or the second row. Is it clear? It seems. Okay. So, as we are nearly out of time, so we will skip discussion about alternatives and let's go to your next homework. So, let's try to take one cardinal variable and let's take also some binary variable and it's up to you whether you would apply one sample t-test or two independent samples t-test. So let's try to use these tests we have just discussed for one cardinal variable and one binary variable. Of course, if your variable is not binary, you can prepared by recoding. So two tasks to test the difference in mean and to test difference in proportions for one cardinal and one binary variable. Next time we will discuss about non-parametric tests which can be used for data that are not cardinal, which are ordinal only. So we will discuss how to create these tests. And of course, now maybe you are asking, okay, but we have just discussed about the test that can compare two groups, but usually I have more than two groups. For example, educational groups, you have four possible groups, or maybe some districts, you have 50 districts in the US, etc., etc. How to compute this task? So believe me, we will discuss about the general procedure, which is called analysis of variance, which will tell you how to analyze differences between more than two groups. So that will be covered also in the next lecture. So that's all for today. Enjoy the day and feel free to ask me if you have any questions. Yeah?
Which data set should we use?
UVS data set, yeah. The same as for all homework. And of course, if you like to use the same data we used for lectures, you can use it as well. There are also some more cardinal variables, so it's up to you. Of course, if you have your own data, you can use it. Feel free to use every data you have, but these are my recommendations. These are prepared for you. Okay, bye.